So, take the case of the Germans. The Protestant Reformation, a key moment happens when Martin Luther translates the Bible into German, and this happens at the same time as the printing machine is invented, which is a key issue in the formation of modern languages. And suddenly this Bible, which is translated in one dialect of German, because again, there is no one German, suddenly this one dialect of German gets, the Bible is translated in this one dialect of German, and what was the book that everybody had and read was the Bible, and with the printing machine it manages to spread everywhere. And that's how you standardize the language. And then you have literature that is written by authors and who contribute to creating a standard language. But look what you don't have throughout Germanic, the history of the German people's history. What you don't have, clearly, as you can see, is one state. One state. Same set of borders. You had thousands of princedoms there. All part of this vague Holy Roman Empire of Germanic nation, Germanic language, which is, a vague association of these princedoms. Thousands of them. And again, you saw that the spheres of authority changed and so on. So, how do you define who? Okay, we speak German, but we also want, we saw how successful these unified states are, especially Prussia, which is also a Germanic state. We want such a unified state. Then we also agree to the idea that people should govern themselves. But which people? The Germans. But who are the Germans? How do you define who is German? Okay? And you're going to say, well, obviously those who speak German. Excuse me, Swiss people speak German. Dutch is a German dialect. Austrian is a German dialect. Which German? And here you see the complexity. Here you see the fact that the nationhood, the way it's understood, is itself also a construct. Not that it's built on nothing, because there are dialects of similar languages, but where do you draw the border, and where do you draw the border where there is no common border? Well, so first, what the Germans would have to do was to define nationhood, and that's the process of nation building, which is different, although can go in parallel with the process of state building. Nation building is defining nationhood. And you do it through what? You do it through language. You standardize and define this is the German language and you spread it. You do it by creating a cultural output that becomes a common cultural output. The German philosophers, Hegel, Fichte, Schlegel, and so on. The German poets, Goethe, Heine, and so on. Schiller. All of these create a body of culture to which, if you associate yourself, you are German. You can also refer to low culture, right? Folk music and so on, which at this point is discovered as a thing. Dances, the way they dress, and it's become, who cared how the peasants dressed and danced and whatever beforehand? Well, suddenly it becomes a thing, and it becomes associated with identity. And they start collecting all these things and say, okay, this is part of our identity. This is what makes us German. So, language, cultural output, popular folk culture, what else? Creating cultural institutions, theater, educational system, universities, newspapers, all of these that would propagate the German language, the German culture, and another thing, number five, history. Because suddenly now every group will start writing their history. But again, to write your history, you have to define that there is an I. Who is us? We talk about American history. Now, if you would live in the 1750, there is no American history, is there? It's British history. You always read it backwards. But today we include that in American history, even the things that preceded 1750. Right? Well, so you write history, but you write it in a specific key. Suddenly everything led to this. There is a people that has come through history and has gotten here. Which is false, blatantly. I mean, it's only partially correct, let's say put it this way. Because the Franks themselves were Germanic, weren't they? And they're not German, they're French, seemingly. Okay? So, but you read this, back, you say, okay, there's a history of us, our history, and we read history in that key, so to speak. Right? So, here you have the second way of defining nationhood, which is ethno-culture. And it's pretty straightforward. Those entities that have a political, those lands that have a political organization of their own, meaning statehood. If you have statehood, chances are you will define nationhood based on the pre-existing statehood. Because what's the point of defining nationhood? It's not just for fun. It's to claim certain political rights. Based on this whole idea of democracy, you're going to claim that there is such a thing as us, defined this way, and we claim the right to govern ourselves. Just like the Declaration of Independence says. It defines an us, and it says we have the right to govern ourselves. When you are a German, you will define such a thing. You see, there is such a thing as Germanhood, the German nation, which I just defined because it's who are those? Those who speak German, follow this German culture, have this shared history, and religion can also be part of it, and so on. Because there is an us, we claim self-rule. But notice, if this is fairly straightforward here, although it takes genocide to convince some to be in it, right? How can you do this here? And how can you do this in sanctuary room? Because guess what? In what situations do the Central European, Central Eastern European peoples find themselves? At the time when this idea of nationhood becomes prominent and self-governance becomes prominent. Are they in the situation of France? Unfortunately not, although they could have been. This is not 1800, this is 1700. What do you have here? An old historical commonwealth of Poland and Lithuania. There is state. It would be very easy to define nationhood based on this statehood, which has historical, you know, tradition, and it's been there. But this is 1700. What is it actually going on at 1800? Poland disappears! Poland disappears! And it will be gone for 120 years. While this process is going on. So how would they define themselves? Because they can't define themselves based on nationhood, on statehood, which has disappeared. Because it has become part, split between, divided between other states. Right? The memory will not be lost, right? There is a part of state-based, political-based national self-definition in Poland. But what they will be left, they will have to define themselves ethno-culturally. Which was never the case in the Polish history. Remember, the Polish nation was the nobles. It was a politically defined, it was your belonging in the political institutions that govern the land, the same, right? Your belonging to a specific strata in the society that gave your national identity, or in the sense of belonging to the political entity of Poland. But that's gone. And guess what is going on with Hungary? The same thing. It had strong statehood for centuries. It's lost. First because of the Ottomans, and then divided between Ottomans, then part of the Habsburg Empire. Is it completely lost? No, because there are still some institutions. So there's a political dimension. But what do you say about the Romanians? They never had a state. They never had a state. And yet they discover that they speak a language different from, not they discover, they sort of, this becomes important, that they speak a language different from Hungarian and different from every Slavic language. So there is such a thing as Romanian, and they create this identity. They recover this identity in order to claim that statehood that never existed. So what sort of nation building happens basically throughout Central and Eastern Europe? It will be basically mostly based on ethno-cultural aspects. Which again, what is ethno-cultural identity? Is language, is history, again, doesn't have to be real, right? Can be imaginary, is culture, high and low, so high culture, traditions, way of life, can be religion. Because for Romanians, it will be crucial to their identity as Romanians that they're Orthodox, although not all of them will be. Or for the Serbians, remember that this became what defined them under the Ottoman Empire. You see how important it is to understand the fate of the Slavic, different Slavic peoples who speak similar dialects, by the way, under the Ottoman Empire. They will build it on the set of institutions of the Orthodox Church will be crucial to define Serbian identity. The Polish, who have always had a state, now that they lost it, what maintains their culture? How will they define their nationhood? Well, they will have language, they will have left culture that governs right, especially now, there will be a history which is mostly political history, not ethnic history, traditions, but religion will become crucial. Because it just so happens that they will be put taken over by an Eastern Orthodox Empire, Russian, and aggressively Protestant state, Prussia. So they will be oppressed in both hands because they're Polish and because they're Catholic. So suddenly being Catholic will become the mark that defines Polishness. Furthermore, when you lose statehood, remember, just like here in the Ottoman Empire, like it happened to the Bulgarians and the Serbians, in order for an entity to remain, a people to remain as a society, as a people that recognizes itself as a people, not nation, let's not use that anymore, carelessly, they need a set of institutions. And for both these Bulgarians and Serbs, and later for the Polish here, it will be the church, the given church, that will actually have the institutions, right, which will maintain their identity. This ongoing reality of the institutions is crucial in order to, it shapes reality, it shapes community, it shapes the society, it constitutes society. Without institutions, sets of institutions, there is no society. And it will be the church here, the Catholic Church and the Orthodox churches here, that will become the backbone of national identity and the preserver of national identity. So in all these lands, you will see that the churches, the traditional churches, have been closely associated with culture, with preserving traditional culture, language, and literature, for example. Because in the 19th century, they became the carriers and the maintainers of these, what we call them, you know, parts of identity. So basically what you have in throughout Central and Eastern Europe is a nation building, is a national self-definition process, which includes standardizing language, writing an own history, discovering, rediscovering, rewriting our history, who is us, we're just defining it, creating and spreading high culture, mostly poets. All these poets will be nationalistic poets, they will write about the nation, the historical nation, they write historical poetry and novels and whatever. So literary tradition and institutions of culture, right? So writing, cultural production and cultural institutions. Theater, newspaper, as I said, these will spread this idea of a common culture and of a common identity, right? And perhaps the institutions of religion, right? All of these will be involved and enrolled in defining nationhood. With what goal? Once you define yourself in the 19th century, you have to be someone, i.e. a nation, in order to claim self-determination, political self-determination. So in order to claim the right to go to have your own state, you will have to claim that you are some entity distinct from the other entity, and in the names of self-determination and freedom and all these, you know, values, you will claim the right to govern yourself. But you're going to say, okay, this also is nice. I see some friction, I see some conflict, some of these empires are not going to be happy. But otherwise, it's okay. Is it, though? Are borders between different ethnic nations nicely drawn and separated? No, they're not. Because in the same area live this small area here, remember Kundera, live people in the same village who speak German, who speak Hungarian, who speak Romanian, who speak Serbian, who speak Bulgarian, who speak Slovak, who speak, Gypsy. And I'm not exaggerating. And Jewish. To who, which state will they belong? That's the problem. This is at the heart of the politics and of the issue and problem of Central and Eastern Europe. That the modern paradigm of the nation-state, which assumes, why do we call it nation-state? That each nation should have a state. And remember, these are different things. Nationhood and statehood. Defined differently. Because these are all nations in search of a state. France was a state in search of a nation. As the United States was. State in search of a nation. But in most parts of the world, in fact, including Africa, this is why you have all these wars of borders and whatever, because the world never was divided neatly into nations. This is a forced interpretation that we have constructed in the 19th century, basically. It's not that people haven't been talking different dialects, because we talk about this fact. And there has been sort of a communal identity in various levels. But this idea of neatly separated, distinct groups Some are hobbits, some are elves, some are gnomes, some are orcs, some are whatever. And they all look different, they speak different language and have different things, and they all have their little place. This is not human reality. This is not the reality of human existence, and never has been. But it has become. And it has become the reason why most blood has been shed since in the last 2 centuries has been nationalism. Now, let's review here very briefly but clearly the difference between state and nation. A state is very simply a set of institutions with sovereign power, which means exclusive power over a territory and a membership. That's all there is. That's all there is. It's a set of institutions. Well, I'm not going to write it down, really write it down. Institutions with sovereign power over a territory and a membership, right? That's what a state is. A nation, however, is something else. Is a group of people united by some shared fundamental identities, one, who also claim the right to self-determination. But which aspect of identity do they claim and based on what is different? This is why we talked about, so a group of people united by, well, who says they're united? They themselves. By some fundamental shared traits of identity who claim political self-determination. But there are two major ways in which nationhood and these entities have been defined. And one is political, and that's the case of the US, that's the case of France, that's the case of even the UK to a degree. Or Australia. Is your Australian if you become a member in the Australian state? It doesn't matter which language you speak, your religion, your traditions, your little folk songs, your little tree theaters and whatever. You simply enroll in the Australian state. This is why they're welcoming to immigrants, because it's a political membership. But that happened in countries that sort of pre-existed nationhood, like France. Right? The country existed before the very modern notion of nation, the way we understand. In most of the other parts of the world, you had changing, you know, various borders that have changed often throughout history. Within which lived people, persons who spoke many different languages. And suddenly in the 19th century you have nations in peoples in search of nationhood, in search of states. Suddenly you have people who never worried about nationhood and claiming sovereignty, like Slovenes, they never had such worries, being forced to claim it after World War I. Literally forced. They were not very happy about this. They were fine in the Habsburg Empire. Why should you have your own state? Because what? Who is your own? What is, why is this better? They didn't want this. Actually didn't want it. Weren't that thrilled, necessarily. It wasn't like something they had been pursuing actively. But you have Germanic peoples who will you know, claim, define nationhood based on what? On ethnocultural traits that we have listed. And then, based on this, they're going to say, well, here's where Germans live based on how we define Germanhood. This should be our state. Well, guess what? That will come about in 1871. There it is. For the first time in history, there's such a thing as Germany. Willy-nilly unification of all the unification, right? Of all those small Germanic. Here's another thing that appears in 1871 that never existed in history. Italy. There has never been such a thing as Italy in history. The Roman Empire has been something, was something else. Was there ever been Italy? No. But this was unified based on the same, this was created based on the same thing. One of the smaller princedoms basically pushed the others to unify. And by the way, the dialects spoken here are very different and so on. Even worse in Spain, which was created over and against peoples here to speak not something that doesn't have anything to do with Spanish. The Catalans, or the Basques, and recently the Catalans had a referendum for independence, recently. Because this, they don't speak anything that resembles Spanish, they don't consider themselves, not even today, 200 years later, or 100 years later, they do not consider themselves part of Spain. This is a state to which they don't belong, because they're a different nation. You see what a powder keg this is. Well, guess what? In Central and Eastern Europe, isn't that the case at this time? At this time, it seems that every single of these language groups, of these, call them ethnic groups, by the way, just because you're an ethnic group doesn't have to be, you don't have to be also a nation, right? All these ethnic groups find themselves where? In, without a state of their own, and in other multinational empires. Which means that they all have to claim and carve their own statehood. And the problem is that you can't really claim and a neatly delineated statehood, because the borders between the different language groups and the different, you know, and who is who is not neat, is not nicely and neatly defined. And you can imagine bloodshed and fight and conflict. You know, civil wars and other things. That follow based on that. So, I will touch on some of the particular aspects of how this process of nation building, right, of defining nationhood, mostly along these ethnocultural lines, through those tools that I have mentioned, happens in each of these cases. With the parenthesis that in the case of Poland and Hungary specifically, there is a history of politically defined nationhood, like the medieval. Understanding that all the nobles were the nation, that to which they will hearken back and they will try to bring in. But the passion and the power of the ethnocultural model will be too strong in the case of Hungary. Or in the case of Poland, they will have no chance to do that because they will simply be in three different empires. So this will be the only remaining model of defining nationhood with which they will be.